for film.
Okay. And what is your name?
Pat.
Pat. Mm-hmm. And you're making everybody famous.
35 years born again Pentecostal.
Okay.
Now non-believer. Can you distinguish or acknowledge a big difference between belief in God and belief in what people have proclaimed about the nature and existence of God, and especially like the feeling, you have a feeling as one of the evidences for God. People have told me that it was God. I believe now that it is a biological, psychological phenomenon, and just how can you have direct faith in God? Isn't just about all of it something that someone has told you that could well be the invention of a mind?
I think what great deal of that I want to agree with. Remember, I stressed that the argument that I presented was only that our experiences of mystery actually can count for something. And I emphasized several times that it might, that it counts for something still has to be weighed against many other things, including arguments of various kinds. And also, another kind of defeater that you're mentioning here is that I may have been enculturated in such a way to interpret my experiences in a very biased way, right? So I've been taught to interpret this evidence, it's real evidence at least you're with me on that, I hope. It's real evidence, but I've been enculturated in such a way as to interpret it in a very biased way, so that I've got to be, it seems to me I've got to be skeptical.
Yeah, I accept it as evidence. I accept it as evidence that you have felt something.
Yes.
You have felt something that seems mysterious to you, but that in no way means that it's God. I see it as a story that you believe in triggers. It causes an emotional experience.
Okay,
it triggers
the question.
Now you get a feeling.
Now the question is that we could try for. You're leaning, let's say I don't want to put you in a bad boat, but you're leaning toward Freud's view. And he says, look, I've got an absolute knockdown argument for all this stuff. Ahead of time, we can rule out all that experience. Now, I would agree that we ought to question that experience. We ought to be skeptical about that experience. But that's not the same as ruling it out.
But still, it is evidence for the possibility of God rather than the existence of God.
Well, along with a lot of other things, it becomes evidence for the existence of God. See, now, in neuroscience, one of the big promises out there right now is that we're going to explain high-order brain... notice that we slip into brain language. We're going to explain high-order mental phenomena in the terms of brain functioning from the bottom up. The reductive program of neuroscience is one of the most biggest promissory notes out there. Maybe it's true, but we haven't got, I mean, there are miles and miles between the stuff at the neural level and the stuff that they say that they can explain. I would be deeply skeptical.
Is there any point that science could get to that would dissuade you from your belief?
Oh, yeah. If it's not possible to have counter evidence, and this is an important point for some religious believers, if it is impossible to have counter evidence to your belief, your belief is actually vacuous. The example I often give in class is a famous 1880s woman reporter. What's her name? Nellie Bly. Nellie Bly gets her, she's famous for, she investigates tenements and all kinds of bad things. She's really brave. She's going to investigate the New York City insane asylum, 1880s. She had, being Nellie Bly, she has herself admitted. After a couple days, she doesn't want to be there. So she goes to the person and says, I'm Nellie Bly, the famous reporter. You need to let me out. They didn't believe her. They had a theory. Anybody in here is crazy. And they would not allow anything that she said to count against their theory. Did that make their theory strong? Of course not. If a religious person has a theory or a hypothesis, whatever you want to call it, of faith in God, and nothing may count against it, it's actually vacuous. So that's nothing wrong.
So what would be, to answer his question?
When Peter asked me this question, how could I persuade this Peter Boghossian, acquaintance of mine, we're not close friends, but we help each other out. How can I, what would be the evidence against the existence of God? I said, bones. Bones of Jesus. The Christian faith stands and falls with the resurrection of Jesus Christ. If you show me bones, but what's the evidentiary problem? Of course there's a huge evidentiary problem. Well, I said, if there is no possible counter evidence, then something is vacuous.
Well, they just found the bones.
Of Jesus?
And the ossuary, whatever.
The ossuary of somebody called James. And because...
it's
a possibility, though. Now, the evidentiary problem is huge, but if I became convinced that this is an ossuary of a guy named Jesus who was crucified on Pontius Pilate, I'd go become a Jew or something.
Well, what is the evidentiary problem with a great miracle worker with thousands of followers, great controversy, great concern from Rome and the Jewish leaders, so many miracles you can't fit them in the book? Why was that never recorded during his lifetime? Why do we have to rely on things 100 years later, 50 years later? And anything, and I've read the Josh McDowell books that are absolute, as far as I'm concerned, a black mark on Christianity for the apologetics. Why don't you see an evidentiary problem that something that phenomenal in a place and time so well recorded just didn't end up, except for later claims made later in retrospect?
Well, we have to talk about the history of the oral transmission of the what's called the tradition of Jesus. There's a lot of technical stuff there.
We're going to give you a minute, and then we
can... I'm feeling I'm taking too much time.
Yeah,
but I would like to say for you, I'm not passionate about my atheism, but I am passionate about the 35 years of my adult life that I worse than wasted because people convinced me that the feeling I had inside was from God and not just something they manipulated so they could control my life.
That's too bad.
To me specifically?
Because you said we're all passionate about it?
Yeah.
If something came up that disproved my non-belief, it's fine. I'd rather know the truth than go on in the delusion that there is no spiritual realm. But I am passionate about how a lot of people are helped, but so many people are controlled and manipulated by other people with getting them to believe that they have some kind of connection or work from God.
I just appreciate the candor with which you speak.
Thank you for enduring.
Thank you. Very helpful, Pat.
I want to make a short comment on this interchange. One of the things Pat talked about was, you know, could we have these feelings and emotions and stuff that are triggering these feelings? And I want to say, when I was an evangelical Christian, I used to read the Bible and pray to God. And when I used to read the Bible, some passages used to strike me in the heart like, wow, what a special tug that is. It's a special feeling. It's like, wow, that's a God feeling. And then sometimes I'd watch a movie that was really touching, and I'd get that same feeling, and it bothered me. It was like, wait a minute, that's supposed to be God's territory, you know? So that would happen a couple of times. And since I left the faith, like just recently I saw the movie Interstellar, and it talked about, you know, it was very big on a relationship between a father and his daughter. And that one hit me a couple of times, you know? And I got that special feeling again. So it's kind of interesting how I used to reserve that feeling just for God. Because I conflated it because I got from reading the Bible initially, and now I see that it's just an emotional doing.
Sir, what was your name?
Or maybe it's God calling you back from the Intel fellow.
I just have a real quick comment. Absolutely.